Is that better? Yep. So really, this is probably an update. So my name's Jeff Schmidt. I'm a technology team manager in Telstra. I look after a team of network engineers that design and build IP carriage for wireless. It's a team of about 16 at the moment. So there's a rough agenda, but by all means, if anyone's got a question and wants to interrupt me, I've got a fair bit of time in this pack, so by all means. So why IPv6? It's probably a fairly straightforward answer. We're running out of IPv4, running out of IPv4 addresses. The traffic growth per device, we see multiple sessions per wireless device these days as well. The VoLTE service in particular, which is voice over LTE, we're running a V6 deployment for VoLTE, which was considered, it was a fair bit easier than other services to build, particularly the mobile broadband service. It's a fair bit more involved in being able to deploy that, but the VoLTE service was probably a fair bit easier because the service you're accessing is contained in a voice service. This is a graph showing the growth in V6 usage, which is bits per second rather than IP flows. So if it was IP flows, it's probably less than that, I would imagine. Also noting there that the tunnel usage is zero, which these days it's not really of interest in V6 deployments. So business and technical considerations. Again, it's probably no surprise that V6 or V4 addresses are depleting. A couple of the registries have run out of addresses now. The US has run out of addresses now, so it's really an issue with the industry. We've had, in Telstra's environment, we don't run pods of the 10 space, the private space. There's certainly some carriers that do that, and they contain all their services and reuse the 10 space. Our issue is actually with the private space in mobiles more than the public space in run out. So we've had a number of challenges to try and extend the private V4 space. And these are the addresses that are attached to the wireless devices as they attach to the network. We don't attach public addresses to the wireless devices. We never really had the public address space to be able to do that. And actually when Jeff Houston was in Telstra many years ago, we did have a meeting to, and he was managing the address space for Telstra at the time. And at the time he basically said, we don't have the public space for devices, the wireless devices themselves, you'll have to do NAT. And that's what we've been doing. There is, to try and connect 10 space to, or extend the 10 space within Telstra, there are some services, particularly streaming services, where if it's a single service serving a national network, to be able to get to it from multiple 10 pods of 10 would be a challenge, not only to translate address spaces, but also in the wireless domain with early HTTP or WAP deployments, the service would offer or use radius to map the phone number, the MSISDN, to the temporary address of the device, and to be able to get that radius packet to the streaming service for a pre-authentication service would be very challenging to build a NAT solution to deploy that. So getting away from, trying to get away from V4 address translation helps avoid continual investment. It's probably more of a, besides the capital expense for address translation, also the operational expense of managing that is higher because of the additional complexities. And as the IPv4 addresses deplete, it becomes even more expensive to extend V4 resources. And initially, we're rolling out a dual stack deployment so that the devices receive both V4 and V6 addresses. But it doesn't solve our issue where we are running out of private space. So we need to move towards a single stack solution as well, so that the devices are just advertised or offered a V6 address. And we will then take pressure off our private address usage. And again, that removes the need to regionalise our network to break up the 10 space and reuse it in multiple geographical areas. If we, and then we could host a single streaming service and access that nationally. Applications are moving towards V6. We have seen Skype was an example of an application that was difficult to run on a wireless device and translate to V4. But we've seen that that has changed, and Skype now runs on V6. And that's partly due to Apple pushing their developers to use V6 natively. So there's some network architecture here. In this diagram, the EPG is a, it's also referred to as a packet gateway. It does the subscriber termination, similar to a BRAS and an ADSL network. And it is configured with pools of address, pools of addresses that are offered to the devices. The CGNAT platform is really just a large scale NAT platform, and it does the translation from the private addresses attached to the wireless devices and then translated to public space as the flows pass through to the internet. Our initial deployments used a lot of one-to-one NAT. We've changed that to use port address translation so that we're able to recover some public address space as we've done that. But there's certainly been lots of challenges with all the ALGs that relate to address translation. The address translation is more complex than simply replacing the IP address in the IP field in the IP packet. A number of protocols have address information within the payload or other headers, and that needs to be adjusted as well in certain applications, and they're called application layer gateways that provide those functions. So here's an example where a single a device is using a what's called a bearer in a wireless domain, which is really a flow between a wireless device and the packet core. That bearer could be dual stack or single stack. In this case, this diagram shows how a flow could pass through to the IPv4 public internet and do address translation, or it could pass directly through to the V6 network natively. And in this diagram, the cloud in the middle, the core network can be addressed in the private space, which is what we've had to do because we simply didn't have enough public space when we built the network. APNs is a mobile's term, access point name, and it's a way of splitting up services or accessing services differently. And there's multiple access point names in our network. One could be for devices to access the early HTTP proxy service, which was originally called a WAP gateway. Another service could be used for laptops to connect to the internet, and that APN we refer to as Telstra.internet. Again, another example of an APN that we use or have configured is an extranet APN where devices are configured with a public space for a small subset of users who can't tolerate address translation. So in this case, we can configure the network to offer a single stack V6 address to the device on an APN basis, or it could be dual stack, it could be V4 only as well, depending on how we set up the network. Also, this diagram, to demonstrate how V6 is configured, the CGNAT platform, or the IBR in that diagram, it advertises a well-known prefix into the core network, which is a little bit similar to a default route for IPv4. So that's advertised into our network, and it's used by the DNS64 to synthesise the quad A record to an A record, so that the in the single stack deployment, the V6 device can get to a V4 endpoint on the internet. And again, this demonstrates that a single APN could also be configured in such a way, or the network could be configured in such a way, that a single APN on a per device basis could request of the network to use single stack or dual stack, so that on a device by device basis we can control what's offered to those devices. So if we know, for example, an iPad will work with dual stack and all the services still work, all the applications still work, we can over the air configure those devices to request dual stack and know that the customer's iPads will, all their services will continue to work. And that's essentially how we will eventually get to going from dual stack to single stack. Is there any difference to the... So some devices, applications might not work as expected. So as Telstra certifies devices, we'll test them so that we know whether they work with dual stack or single stack. So if we know that a device is not ready to run single stack, and we know all the applications work dual stack, we can ensure that those devices only request dual stack. So there's a bit of control, I suppose, so that you could, on a device by device basis. XLAT is used for single stack, and I'll get to that later. Did that answer your question? Slide shows some security information. Capability on the devices themselves these days. There's also an ACL set up in the EPG so that devices are controlled in what they can access across the core. So that purple cloud there in the middle is our core with hosting services like Radius and DNS, and those sorts of services. So we want to control what the wireless devices can get to. Then on the CGNAT platform, with address translation, even 4-to-4 or 6-to-4 translation, there's an inherent protection within address translation so that if a device initiates a flow out to the internet, the return flow will be accepted by the network. Which is really inherent to the way NAT works, not specifically a specific security configuration. But as we move to single stack V6 deployments or native V6 deployments, that behaviour disappears so that unsolicited traffic could be sourced from the internet to the devices and flood devices with traffic that they didn't initiate. And we found that mobile carriers are a little bit sensitive to overbilling in particular, so our intent would be, as we move to native V6, is to have a basic firewall feature, or sorry, a firewall policy that will essentially allow all flows initiated from the wireless device out to the internet and the return traffic, but block anything initiated from the internet to the device. This slide shows really a change in the architecture that's evolving as we move to an NFV environment. So the services that we run in the core, the packet gateway and the carrier grade NAT platform are moving towards the virtual services. So our architectures are evolving to provide or offer a data center type architecture with top of rack switches, spine switches, DC gateways, which is quite different for an access network, but I suppose a new challenge that we're seeing. This slide is really showing different flows. A bit similar to a previous slide in the top two diagrams there, where a V6 flow passes through the NAT platform, but the NAT platform is not doing any NAT in this case. It's just forwarding flows out to the internet, to the V6 internet. That number there is probably a little bit ambitious in that number of traffic, and that would also be bits per second as well, because the IP flows would be substantially less. And really, that's because big providers like Google offer V6 these days. And then the flow in where an IP V6 device is attempting to get to a V4 endpoint, the NAT64 function would be operating there. Now, the bottom diagram there has 464X slat shown there. So what that does is it is a piece of software that runs on the wireless device that will, on the device itself, convert a application that supports only V4 to V6. And then again, the CGNAT platform that does NAT64 will convert that flow back from 6 to 4. So that allows us to run V6 only across the core. And there are still a couple of applications. Skype was one, and Skype isn't anymore, where this capability was quite useful. Also, active FTP is another application we know we have issues with as well. Also, the Android devices are provided with this 464XLAT capability. So, on a device-by-device basis, we could provision Android devices, which we know support this capability, and we know all the services will work. We can, over the air, configure those devices to use single stack. But again, that diagram is shown that amount of traffic is very low, less than 1%. But it's still a problem because, as an operator, customers are used to being able to use, for example, active mode FTP, and if all of a sudden they can't, it's a problem. Yeah. We've also found the with 464XLAT, that's that piece of software running on the device. There's also a capability on the carrier grade NAT platform. So the platform doing 6.4 there, it has to be aware that the device has this 464XLAT service running. And it relates to that ALG capability so that it, if it has to change payload addressing, it has an awareness to be able to adjust that as well. And we are finding that vendors of this carrier grade NAT platforms, some can do this and some can't. So there's still a little bit of immaturity in the industry to fully support single stack V6. So this shows a bit more about 464XLAT. In this example, the source address of the device itself is the 192.0.0.4/32 address. So that source address from the device itself is translated to the 201 DB8 address. And then the source address, again, beyond the CGN, which is running a PLAT service, part of 464XLAT, it'll translate that source address back to a V4 address, and that's the 192.0.2.1 address. In the reverse direction, in the destination direction, the IPv4 address that the wireless device is accessing in this case is the 198.51.100.1 address. Now that address is converted to a V6 address, and in this case you can see the well-known prefix in the 201, the 201 DB8 quad B address. That's the well-known prefix attached to the destination address and the synthesized V6 address. And the destination beyond the NAT remains at 192.51.100.1. So 464XLAT has this CLAT, PLAT arrangement between the device and the CGN as well. So addressing and subnetting, the 3GPP standard currently dictates that devices use a /64. Future releases may require a /60 for tethering. So tethering is where your device tethers using wireless LAN to a laptop, for example. In our case, we're using 4x/44 prefixes per EPG, so 4 million per EPG. And with VoLTE, voice over LTE, it's a separate APN, so another separate set of address pools as well. The last point there, saying that make sure that your addressing is structured, is really just similar to IPv4 in that ensuring that your address space is able to be summarised to keep the number of routes across the network down to a minimal number. So infrastructure addressing, /64 per VLAN, and try and, I guess, standardise it across your network is what that point's saying. Private or public, so remember to use firewalls and policies to avoid advertising infrastructure to the internet. So where we're at the moment, we're running the 10 space on our core, and there's the isolation between the NAT platform and the internet. So there's that inherent protection of our core from the internet. As V6 evolves and you start to address the infrastructure or the core network with V6, I guess that point saying is to be aware that you may not want to allow the internet access to your core network. And that last point is NAT is not really a security capability, it's more that it does inherently behave or provide some control just in the way it works. And as I mentioned before, as you move to V6, you need to consider that the flows getting to devices may be a problem for customers, and particularly overbilling is a problem. So there's some examples here of different carriers that we know of. The carriers aren't listed, but I guess server provider one, server provider X really is, and that's saying that we know of different carriers that have different arrangements set up to support V6. Every carrier will have a different set of circumstances that dictates what method they use, but there's not really a set way of solving this problem. It's really up to the carrier. So it's really up to the carrier to determine what's best for them as well. But I think if the pressure that, and the problem you're trying to solve is to take pressure off the private address space as we have, I suppose that point there is saying that you need to have a strategy to get to single stack, or otherwise dual stack is not really taking any pressure off your private address space. Here I'm mentioning that we are using different APNs for different services. As I mentioned, the Telstra.wap APN is used for devices, where 464X LAT is useful for some of those services that break. DNS64, NAT64 go hand in hand with that solution. Yeah, We have had issues with some devices, particularly BYOD devices. So if customers are receiving a dual stack service where they were previously just using V4, we have seen that some customer BYOD devices will then try and use the V6 address for a service that breaks. And particular examples we see are remote access type VPN services, where we have seen customers have to change registry settings in their laptops to force that RNA service to go back to V4. Otherwise, it will start to use the V6 address as it's offered to the device, and that service breaks. The problem, I suppose, there is that with BYOD devices is that we don't have so much control as to what customers are using or how they're using them. So it's a bit more challenging. There's some configurations there. The HSS is essentially a database that contains subscription information for mobile services. So it would need some configuration to say that dual stack is an option for a subscriber as they attach to the network. The MME is a signalling platform. And it also has a configuration that relates to V6. DAF stands for a dual address bearer flag. So that would need to be set if you intend to use dual stack. The EPG, or the packet gateway, also has some configuration. The PDP type set to dual stack. EPGs are also configured with additional handset pools, so V6 pools as well as V4 address pools, multiple DNS servers for V4 and V6. So the UE, the mobile device requirements and settings. Androids support 464xlat, as I mentioned. It's been around for a couple of years now, so they're the releases that support it that we recommend. So again, also, the as I mentioned earlier, the device can request whether it needs single stack or dual stack. The PDP mentioned there it's a bit like a PPP session in older technologies like dial networks. But in the mobiles network, it's referred to as a PDP session. So as a device is attached to a network and offered an IP address, they could be asking for a dual stack pair of addresses. The network can also force the device. Can be configured to force the device, regardless of what it asks for, to use single stack or dual stack. International roaming over V6 can work, but I suppose the problem is the remote end needs to support V6. There's lots of roaming partners, so it would probably be some time before roaming will work reliably with V6.
Since Androids only support 464xlat, how about iOS? Is still the problem? How's the what is the how you solve the problem for the iOS subscriber that they are going to use 464xlat or IPv6?
Yeah. So Apple have been pushing their developers to support native V6, which is not that far away, actually. So we're hopeful that... We know one carrier that's already deployed this type of arrangement where Apple devices are forced to use single stack because the Apple device, or Apple have been pushing their developers to use native V6, so all their applications support V6. And because all their applications support V6, they don't need 464 XLAT. Yeah. So I guess that's good of Apple to do that, to simplify this problem for us.
So the iPhone users
Well, they could. If the network is configured to allow to offer them a V6 address, the more current releases, and for us, we're hoping this year, we'll certify a device to support single stack V6 on the Apple iOS.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So it is coming around. Yeah.
So the operators still hesitate to update their network to 464 XLAT because the reasons most of the factor that I'm using are because of technology itself.
With 464 XLAT, if it's an Android device, then at the moment we need for all applications to work, we need to think about 464 XLAT. But with Apple, because they've enforced their developers to support V6 natively, 464 won't be required. So that simplifies that problem. It's a device by device basis, so we can over the air configure the device, or we build we test a release that we give to Apple or whoever to configure the devices a certain way for our network. So in doing that, we know that Android will work with 464 XLAT. iOS in Apple can work natively with V6 in the future. So those configurations on the devices will request dual stack or single stack. So that's how we control it on a device by device basis. Yeah, no, they'll use the same APN, but the device will, because if it's an older device, it will request V4 only or dual stack, and it's on a device-by-device basis. So the pre-configuration of that device will, if it's an old device, will just request a V4 single stack address. Yeah. So again, it's on a device by device basis. So the network knows the type of device as they attach to the network, and the network will offer either single stack or dual stack. So some considerations for launch. So we've educated our front of house people about, you know, where we're going and what's happening, and that they may have issues. And as I I mentioned before the issue with laptops where it's a BYOD device. All of a sudden, they're getting dual stack. They're getting a V6 address, so their remote network access service breaks. So we're making sure that front of house are aware of these issues as they arise. There's knowledge bases that we have set up around the organisation that we update. We provide our operations teams briefings on these configurations and as they develop, as the rollout develops. Moderated forums. We offer some a bit more flexibility to get to the engineering teams who are heavily involved with all the history and the development of this solution. We also set up forums. Telstra has a forum called Crowd Support, which is a bit like a industry group that discusses issues in Telstra's network, and we monitor that forum and we'll provide updates if people have issues. So some information on our experience. So as we mentioned, the iPad, now we offer the iPad a V6 address. We haven't seen any issues with doing that on the iPad in particular. And we've seen really good take up on the iPads. They're being offered the address, as I mentioned. They're not causing any problems. And as people update the iOS on their iPad, it's really transparent to them. They just start getting offered a V6 address. So this iOS patch is, like a Telstra build, so that we know, we've tested it, we know that all the applications work and we can control the rollout. And as people update their devices, they start receiving a V6 address. We're planning single stack later this year. And that's where we start to really take some pressure off the private address space that we have at the moment. So this graph shows the take up of the V6 addresses as the iPads started to use the V6 addresses. Unfortunately, I had to take off the information on the other axis. So it's still, a small percentage of traffic, but it's tens of thousands of sessions now that are using V6 addresses. So BYOD devices. Legacy devices configured with V4 are not impacted. New devices configured with a dual stack will receive both addresses. And as we go forward, existing devices will be with V6 only. There's a list of ALGs there that I mentioned earlier, the application layer gateways. They're the ones in particular that have been challenging for us. And even H323 has been late again in the industry to offer the ALG at all. There certainly has been numerous challenges with the ALGs, and also going from one-to-one NAT to PAT, we had challenges. One example there was with male. As we went from one-to-one NAT to PAT, the mail services on the internet would see a flood of mail requests come from a single address, and then they would blacklist that address. So there's lots of these little challenges. Yeah. This is saying, this point here is saying that as some applications fail with V6 with 464 XLAT, may well be just a routing issue if V6 is routed differently across the network. There's not really much that breaks now with 464 XLAT. The VPNs are a problem. That's again related to the point I made about remote access on BYO devices. Some of them still break. HTTP and HTTPS works well. SSH works well as well. V6 being faster, I'm not sure really whether that's a lot of truth in that, but you'd expect the same performance with V6, a similar performance. Address translation might cause a very small amount of latency, but I think as we've moved away from tunneling, the performances really should be very similar. So all the major applications work well now. Again, a bit more about customer support. Engage the community, so there's a little bit of repetition here now. Support email through contact points and reply soon. You know. Skip the red tape, so that's saying allow engineering more access to front of houses and other parts of the organisation to help support the rollout. Also, if the graphs do impress people as they see usage and allows you to gain support to continue rollout. Any more questions?
So how about example, there is a customer connected from a base station and then access DHCP. And at core network we have already configured SIP and 4, right? So about the
HTTP,
which one should provide to customer first?
Sorry, the...
Normally, when there is a subscriber access from base station, and then the HTTP server will provide...
An address?
IP, right?
Yeah.
So, 64 or...
64.
64?
Is it... Sorry, the...
You said... For example, the device is for the dual state, for 6 and 4.
Yeah.
And his question is, what is the priority IPv4
right.
or uses?
Yeah, for the HTTP to subscriber.
Okay.
From our core network.
Wireless core network to mobile.
Yeah.
So the priority, we use address pools rather than DHCP, but the device is configured in a way to ask for either a V4 address or a dual stack V4 and V6 address or V4 only. So the priority, it's because the device is asking for a single stack, for example, it'll get a single address. Whether it's using an address pool on a packet gateway or a DHCP, would be the same behaviour.
But if the terminal available for 6 and 4 also, so it can be an alternative to get the DHCP?
The device will either ask for single stack or dual stack. So it we'll either get a single address or both addresses. Is my understanding your question?
His question is, I think he said that the,
I mean, some
consider on your stack, your stack technologies.
Yeah.
Before, he said, not single stack.
Okay, dual stack.
No,
the priority.
I mean that example is the terminal example access request work time and get fixed, and then disconnect and then request again. Example can get four again or alternative like that.
They'd have to re-establish their PDP session, so they'd have to reconnect to the network. Oh, I see. So the application. Yes. Well, if the device has got both addresses, V4 and V6, it's really up to the application to decide whether to use the V6 address or the V4 address. So the application will choose on the device itself. So the example I explained before where the BYOD device, the remote access service stopped working, so like a VPN service stopped working, the registry setting in the Windows operating system had to be changed to force the remote access service to use V4. So it's really the application that makes the decision on whether to use the V6 address or the V4 address.
So the first attach, to the network, so the mobile will get both IPv6 and V4 at the same time.
As it attaches, yeah. So prefix delegation, So as a if it's a tethered device, then a V6/64 would be /60 could be used. And that delegation of that subnet sits behind a tethered device. We're not using that, but it is something that we're thinking about. Which one was that? Sorry. We're giving them information to update registry settings or change back to V4 only. So really, we're as we come across those types of issues, we're gathering that information so that we can help customers resolve them. But BYOD devices are a little bit more challenging in that we don't control the settings. So, So that VPN service I mentioned was an application that breaks. It's called Microsoft Direct Access is the name of the service. Why it breaks, I can't really say. It's like a remote access service. So if you're wanting to access your corporate network, it's a tunneling type service. So something specific to that particular application. Well, in that case, really all we did was we changed the registry settings in the operating system to force that application to go back to V4. Potentially you could, yeah. So once you remove the NAT service altogether and you're just routing V6, potentially the internet can send traffic to your device. Potentially you could, yes. We're likely to put a policy, put a basic firewall service where the NAT was to prevent that, so that the internet can't initiate traffic to the wireless devices. We find that the cost of their data service is higher, so customers complain about overbilling. If it was, a fixed line access, that's the general behaviour, I think, that the device is exposed to the internet and the internet can flood it with traffic. But mobile's environment's a little bit different because customers are paying more for that traffic and they're a bit more concerned about that unsolicited traffic hitting their devices. But I mean, probably different carriers will treat that problem differently. But yeah, it is a challenge. For some subscribers, we have had for a long time an APN called Extranet, where in that case we give a public address to a device, just for a subset of customers who want that direct access to the internet without any address translation. And in that case, they understand, those customers, that the internet can send traffic to their device, and they accept that. Yeah, for that case, yeah. That's one option. So I think you're referring to the slide with the security information with the access control list on the packet gateway. DDoS is still a challenge for sure. So the likely deployment for us will probably have we won't be doing the address translation, but we will still have some capability to control flows of traffic, as I was just talking about, where only the devices that initiate a flow allow the return traffic to get back. So there will be a basic firewall rule to control that, but also some denial of service capability to protect the core as well. And as we move to cloud environments where the internet can connect directly into those cloud environments, we're going to have some denial of service protection to protect those environments. Yeah. And we do see... Sorry? Security solutions for VCs. Sorry? Material reference information. Not really, no. I can't think of any reference information that we've really used. I'm sure there probably is. It's really the ISP environment, like in particularly fixed networks, is really just an open access. It's really up to the subscriber to protect their device. The mobile environment is not that much different. It's really, you're connected to the internet, so you're exposed to the internet. So it's really up to the user to run some security software on their device to protect their device. Any control we do as a carrier to control that traffic, in some ways we're doing it because we just want to help our customers, but also, you know, really as a carrier we could just make it open access and then put the whole responsibility back onto the customer to protect their device, because, you know, really that's how the cable network works, and you know, GPON services and other access networks. We're very interested in protecting our infrastructure, so we put controls in there. Yeah. Any more questions? So I've just got a couple of facts there. Has done a lot of work. He works for me, my team, and he's done a lot of work in this area, and has presented these slides around the place, different forums as well. That's it, I think. Okay. Thanks, everyone.